Hey, it's Jennifer here from Belladonna's Botanicals, and I am trying to put together this series here based on a lot of the content that I've been developing for the past almost 5 years. And this is sort of like the introductory. So you're going to kind of see timeline jumping around, and my hair is going to change a whole bunch of times in the past 5 years. So not entirely sure. I'm working on what I want to kind of call this. But this is the three tenets of this are like awakening, empowerment, and liberation. And a lot of that is coming through the exploration of the dark goddesses, as well as some of the more darker spirits and deities and things like that. The first thing I want to mention here is there is some, I mean, we have the historical definitions and usage of terms like dark magic and black magic versus white magic, or, you know, nowadays it's more called like the new age love and light versus white magic. Some of these are problematic terms. I'm only using them because they're the terms of that people know and would be searching for. I tend to kind of look at the magic practice in here as full spectrum magic. No one is going to be looking for that yet, but what I want to say about that is those terms can be rooted very much in white supremacy. And I'm not talking about like, you know, the KKK or anything like that. I'm talking about white Eurocentric power and domination and stuff like that. So that's something to keep in mind when we're using those terms. Now, they've been used in a lot of different historical contexts. Yes, they can have racist overtones, as a lot of time dark magic or black magic is used to describe things like voodoo and Santeria and Palo and things like that of the ATRs. So I just want to kind of give that quick little at the beginning. And that said, welcome to the newcomers of the awakening, empowerment, and liberation of the dark goddess, as it were. Many of us, you know, of the elders, that, and I'm saying elders, isn't specifically age specific. I'm just saying, you know, people that have been working with these particular spirits for a very long time. Like I've been working with Lilith for going on 5 years now, pretty regularly. So she is my matron deity. So there we go. So many of us have been doing this work, and we're here to help you and guide you along the journey. So our goal in that is because there's such a huge amount of absolute crap and BS coming from the stem to stern, tip to tail ends of the spiritual magic witchcraft spectrums, whether you're looking at like the woo-woo love and light end of things all the way up into like the left-hand path. There's a lot of problematic stuff out there. And what I want to do is make you aware. You are able to make your own decisions, but you know, at the end of the day, if the leopard eats your face because you decided to join a cult, at least we've warned you. So that's what we're looking for. And also in that stem to stern of the occult, spirituality, wellness industries, I'm talking like yoga and Reiki and stuff like that too. There has been a huge influx of the QAnon conspiracy, MAGA, you know, all that stuff. And this is not a place for that. And we will warn you on who and whatnot, where you might be ending up in like, yeah, you want to be careful with that. Because the last thing I want to see is someone ending up in like having a terrible experience coming in looking for the right kind of creators and ending up in a MAGA cult. So anyways, I've been creating a wealth of content over the past 5 years. I'm going to be trying to organize it a little better to make it a little more congruent, easy to follow, I guess, because it's all over the place right now. Apologies. But anyways, I'm Jennifer. I am a neurodivergent, disabled, but not disabled enough to qualify to get on disability, because I'm not poor enough to get onto disability. But I'm still living, you know, deposit to deposit, trying to, you know, cover things. I have autoimmune disease. I have chronic pain, joint issues, and a whole bunch of other things. And I'm also on the spectrum. So I have that wonderful, I'm also talking with my hands way too much, the ADHD and autism. So I am very much into making magic accessible for people, because not everyone can, you know, pop open a book and be like, well, I can't build a 9-foot, you know, ritual space in my backyard because I'm in a wheelchair, or I have chronic pain, so I have to work in a very different manner than, say, someone who is able-bodied, or if I'm visually impaired or stuff like that. So I'm really trying to make things as accessible, because, like, sometimes, and I talk about this a lot in videos, and you'll see that people get really stuck on, it has to be by the book and by tradition, and there's no deviations or it won't work. So really, if someone can't do this 12-day ritual because, you know, they have chronic pain or something, that it, their magic's not going to work for them. No, that's stupid. I'm sorry. I'm very upfront and blunt about things. You can make modifications. I'm all about making magic work for you, meeting you where you're at, and for you to get the best results from what you are doing. Whether you are just starting out, whether you, no matter what practice you are and what tradition, your magical practice is valid. We all make mistakes from time to time, and it's a learning process, but, you know, we're here to say, hey, you know, this is my experience with that. Like, I will always give the advice of be as specific as possible when you're doing spell work, because sometimes magic takes the path of least resistance. And sometimes if you are not specific, it's just going to kind of like sneak in somewhere, and results may vary. So before I move on, I want to say one thing, especially to people. I know in this time right now in America, there is a lot of upheaval and fear and stuff like that, because so many of us are going to be negatively impacted if we're lucky to survive some of the stuff that's coming through Project 2025. It's terrifying for a lot of people. I mean, I'm staring down the barrel of potentially at some point in time losing my Affordable Care Act insurance. And when you have multiple chronic ongoing illnesses that need maintenance, it's kind of scary. So, but the first thing I want to say here is a lot of us are new to feeling this fear, this, like, especially like with the your body, my choice crap that's been going around kind of things. Like, it's hard. Like, I had, like, the first few days, like, my body, just when I left the house, I did not know how to feel safe. But the thing that I had to, you know, I processed through my PTSD and staying present and all of that. But the thing that I had to really sit down and decenter myself is that the lack of safety and fear that we are feeling, a lot of us are feeling right now, has been the lived experience of Black and Brown people in this country and in the world for centuries. So, you know, in this country, I mean, we're founded on blood and genocide. I mean, by, you know, you have the slavery, you have the everything with the indigenous folks and stuff like that. So it we need to acknowledge that that is something that has been present in this country for hundreds of years. And that is a lived experience of those people. So that said, I just wanted to give a little bit, hold some space for that, because that is a big thing. Now, if you're just entering into the, okay, I want, you know, you're feeling the calling to working with the Dark Goddess. Great. That's awesome. That's where I was 5 years ago. So, and I got working with Lilith around the beginning of that thing that happened in March 2020. Sometimes using certain words for things, especially if you're monetized, can get you shadow banned or flagged and stuff. So, where to start is always the hardest and easiest question at the same time. I came back into my practice after a very long period of time in which I had not been actively practicing, and kind of fell into the pragmatic, agnostic, atheist realm for a very long time. And I was a little reluctant to work with spirit. I had already been into my practice for quite some time, again, before I really started being like, who do I want to work with? And at that point in time, you know, I was just exploring. I was feeling more drawn to sort of the dark magic aspects. And So I just kind of started building. I'm an avid learner, so I just started picking up some books and taking courses and all of that. So it ended up being that the first spirit that I felt a drawn to, I can't really explain why. It just was like an undercurrent, was Lilith. So that's why, and I've been working with her now for almost 5 years. And you'll start to see different things. So I started, and I have several videos that kind of chart my working with Lilith over the years. The first video that I have working with Lilith at the very beginning has always been my most popular video on here. So hopefully a lot of people have come to Lilith from that video. So there's different spirits. And so which goddess do you want to work with? So you might be finding that you're called to working with a specific goddess or in a specific area. So I've seen a lot of people looking at Lilith and Hecate and Medusa, the Morrigan I've seen come up for a lot of people. And that's great. What I would say there is if you're seeing the signs or you're feeling called to working with a particular goddess, start looking into them. Look up videos, look up books, look up anything you can find. There's tons of meditations and binaural beats and all sorts of things like that for all these different spirits. And it doesn't have to be goddesses. Work with what works with you. Work for what works with you. I mean, my patron is Lucifer, and if you're talking about re rebellion and defiance against like that, definitely a good spirit to work with. It was through Lilith that I started working with Lucifer. So I've worked with them both. Lucifer's my patron. So I've worked with them very intensely for the past 5 years. So that's what I say there. So if you feel drawn to a particular area, just start doing a little research, feeling out what are other people's experiences with working with Hecate or Lilith or the Morrigan, or any deity. So how do you know which goddess is calling to you? You might get specific things. Sometimes there'll be animal symbols. Like where I live, I'm constantly surrounded by crows and black vultures, which to me, I've always felt the presence of the Morrigan here. So I don't work with the Morrigan regularly, but she's kind of in my spiritual arsenal. So and you can work with multiple spirits. I would suggest starting with one and working from there. That's what I did. Lilith, my experiences in working with Lilith is like she connected me with all the other major players I needed to work with, or when I started working with them. Lilith or Lucifer were usually like my psychopomp or my intermediary for getting to know those other spirits. So, or getting introduced to them. I'm going to make a separate video touching upon, well, maybe. So how do I navigate being cognizant of closed practices and cultural appropriation? So this is where the research comes in handy. I would say like if you're looking at something that is not within the cultural appropriation is really going to hit a lot the areas of indigenous practices and spirituality and the ATRs, African traditional religions. So you're getting into some of that there. I would just make sure in that process that you're not stepping on any toes or starting to explore something that maybe you want to hold off on for now, because you can. There's a lot there. I'm going to talk about some stuff in other videos about that a little more in depth. So that's one thing. Where do you start? Well, pick a place and start. For me, I started connecting with Lilith through deep meditation. And in the beginning, it was, maybe 5 or 10 minutes here, 20 minutes there, or through like astral travel, or what we call in the demonology practice is ascension mode, where you kind of transcend to that plane and work with the spirits there. So that was how for me. Now I am ADHD, so meditating is not the easiest thing for me. So if you can only do a couple minutes at a time, great. You might well split it up throughout the course of your day. Few minutes in the morning, maybe doing take a little walking break when you're at work or in school or whatever, and a little bit at night. And each day build upon that a little bit more. Rome wasn't built in a day and your practice won't be either. So that would be what I would say as far as like where you want to start there. And you might look at something like right now, I am really doing a deeper dive into my own cultural heritage, into Slavic witchcraft. I'm Eastern European, of Ukrainian descent. I've got the whole Carpathian swath covered in my genetics. That sounded dirty. Didn't mean it that way. But that's where my ancestry comes from. So there's a lot of things to me there that are that speak to me, whether it's Bohemian magic, whether it's Slavic, Ukrainian, a lot of working with Baba Yaga and like a lot of folk practices. So you might look at that and go, oh, okay, well, I'm Irish. So maybe I'm going to, you know, look at the Celtic pantheon, or, oh, I'm German. Let's look at sort of that Anglo-Saxon kind of pantheon, or you want to explore Nordic traditions and stuff like that. Go for it. You know, I'm going to make something a little more specific about some of the cultural appropriation and close practices in a separate video. I'm just going to try to keep these videos a little shorter because I can be long-winded. But I would, I'm going to give you a couple, or maybe a few, book recommendations of things that will help get you started on this. The first one I'm going to give you is the Encyclopedia of Spirits. The Ultimate Guide to Magic of Fairies, Genies, Demons, Ghosts, Gods, and Goddess by Judilka or Judika Illis. This is going to be what I like about this book. I'm a giant nerd. I'm almost done reading this book. But what I really like about this is that she gives you, I'm just looking for someone I recognize as I'm flipping through here. So she's going to give you what area the spirits are from. So like Ereshkigal is from Sumeria. So she also gives you like, because sometimes gods have their own beefs with each other. And especially if you're getting into the Greco-Roman stuff. So if there's like, okay, you can work with both these gods together, but don't, you know, do offerings or rituals to them at the same time. These goddesses need to have separate altars. Like, for instance, like the Morrigan tends to either need a separate altar or a very messy altar. Like she likes a lot more earthy things. Like I tend to have her, I have her on my main goddess altar, but she's kind of got her own little surrounding of, I'm like, here's your special rocks and skull stuff and your little statue here, you know, and some, you know, dirt and leaves and twigs and rock that's like just hers. Santa Muerte, you really need to have like a separate altar for her. And she likes stuff. She likes a lot of offerings. So that's what I like about this book. And it also tells you every single one. Like, listen here, Lizdona, that's a Lithuanian spirit. Now that's something I would feel comfortable, you know, going in that sort of Slavic witchcraft of working with that, where you know, let's see, Malalo is a Romani Transylvanian gypsy. So that's something that you might want to be like, that feels a little kind of on that. I'm not sure if that's closed or not, or would be in the cultural appropriation area. So this is like a good like primer, like resource, like, hey, I just heard of this. Who is Azazel? You know, like, you can kind of go in there. The only thing I will say about this one is if you're looking for some of the more obscure grimoric demons, they probably won't be in here. Some will. Some of like the more fallen angels and ones that were demonized from pre-Christian pagan gods. So this is a good resource for that. The next one, similar resource, this is M. Bellinger's Dictionary of Demons. This has most of what, you know, we would call demonic in there and dark spirits and all of that. I will wager to guess that it's probable that some of the Ducante hierarchy demons are not in here. Like, I don't see Aslan listed. So some of the Dukante, I won't get too much off on that. I'm going to do a separate video on some of the grimoire traditions that inform what you'll see more in like the left-hand path and demonolatry practices. So while I'm on the topic of demonolatry practices, I do recommend Four Demon Queens by S. Conley and J.C. Decasari. And this one includes Lilith, Hecate, they believe Tezzerian and Dilipitore. But these are really, I like her. I love her work. She's a great person. And check out our podcast that we did earlier this year. So she gives you very, you can change and modify any of the rituals and stuff in here. They're usually pretty straightforward. She talks about, you'll get what planet they're associated, stones, tarot cards, all of the correspondences that you'll see. So this is good. She will be having a Dukante hierarchy pathworking book coming out. I do highly recommend her stuff if you're interested in the demonolatry thing or aspect. So this was probably the first book I read on Lilith, The Temple of Ascending Flames, Lilith, Dark Feminine Archetype. And this has a lot of stuff from a lot of different occult authors, some of which I know. So we have Azanoth Mason. She's really well regarded and works of that. She's part of the Temple of Ascending Flame. Bill Duvendak, Edgar Cavall. I think there's anyone else I know in here off the top of my head. So this book is going to give you an interesting perspective on working with Lilith and some of her, there's all different contributors in here to the different aspects. So whether, Lilith and the Mask of Medusa or Lilith, the Selenic face of Lilith, Lilith, Samael and Leviathan. So you're going to have different aspects here. So I found this was the first one that kind of really got me on my journey. So that helped. This book is good for more of a history sort of aspect of Lilith. And it's called Lilith, Mother of All Dark Creatures by E.R. Werner. So, and that's, again, very, big print, this simple read. I could probably sit down and read this in an hour or two. I haven't finished reading this yet, but similar to the Lilith Dark Feminine Archetype, we have Hecate, Witchcraft, Death, and Nocturnal Magic. And this is from the Temple of Ascending Flame by Azanoth Mason and other authors. So we have, again, we have her, Bill Duvendak, Edward Cavall. Look at some of the other names in here. Yeah, just different occult authors. So, and you're looking at, Hecate, the three faces of Hecate, spiritual alchemy, different workings, soul alchemy, all sorts of stuff. So there are obviously tons of other books on Hecate. Some of them I have to go through everything because I have books everywhere. There's books in my bed right now. So I'm that person. Anyways, so I think that's probably what I want to give you as for just some basic over here, just for some basic like reference guides as to what you might be like to kind of get you started there. I have a vast wealth of books, audiobooks, ebooks. I have stuff everywhere. I really need to kind of catalog it so I can have some better recommendations for everyone. Excuse me. But yeah, I just wanted to give you a little intro to let you know we're committed to guiding you through this journey of your own spiritual awakening, your empowerment, and your liberation. So, and especially during this dark time of magical resistance, and this is when there are these major turbulent times in human history, you will see an uptake in you know, magical practices and witchcraft, working with goddesses and stuff of that nature. So, and we're here to answer your questions, help guide you. And I will be producing a lot more content. I just outlined a whole crap load of videos today. So stay tuned. And thank you for watching. Don't forget to click like and subscribe. Be sure to follow us on social media. Sign up for E's newsletter so you always know what's going on. I send out links to all the videos because algorithms suck. And you'll see our product drops and anything new coming on. Definitely check us out on Threads. There's a lot of great conversations happening there. So anyways, I will see you guys later. Bye.